So anyway, welcome to the first research meeting of 2024. And we have a great meeting today. And this is a great session because we're letting the people that won the awards from last year actually present. And the first presentation is from Emily Bell. And she won the People's Choice Award from the Research Forum last year. And her presentation is titled Using SUpported Motivational InTerviewing to Improve Physical Activity for People with Knee Osteoarthritis.
So thank you very much for the introduction there. I'll skip straight to my acknowledgement. So I'd like to start by acknowledging, doing an acknowledgement of country. There might just be someone who's got their microphone on there. So I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which I work and live, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and extend my respects to their elders, past and present, and any warm welcomes to anyone who's joining us today. I'd also like to acknowledge Cabrini Health Arthritis Australia and La Trobe University for funding to complete this pilot study. And also acknowledge my research team and our participants, without whom we wouldn't have this trial to be presenting. So knee osteoarthritis is prevalent, burdensome, and expensive. We know that education and exercise improve pain, function, and quality of life, and are commonly recommended by guidelines. A common program in Australia called the Good Life with Osteoarthritis Denmark program, or GLAD, has reported to address knee-related concerns. And despite the efficacy of the GLAD program, this does not translate to an increase in physical activity. This is important because people with knee osteoarthritis, this is important because knee osteoarthritis and insufficient physical activity are independently associated with greater comorbidity risk, including cardiovascular disease and earlier mortality. And behaviour change interventions such as motivational interviewing may be effective to increase physical activity in other musculoskeletal conditions, but have been minimally tested in knee osteoarthritis to date. Therefore, our primary aim was to develop and test the feasibility of a motivational interviewing and multimedia web-based platform, so our intervention named SUMIT, compared to usual care in people with knee osteoarthritis. Our secondary aim was limited efficacy testing, specifically the effect of SUMIT on the listed outcomes. People who have completed GLAD reported feeling more confident to participate in physical activity. Therefore, we recruited people who had completed GLAD within 2 years with a diagnosis of knee osteoarthritis. Our primary outcome was feasibility, and our secondary outcomes included physical activity, knee-related burden, health-related quality of life, physical fitness, function, and general health. Feasibility included five criteria which were determined prior to recruitment, and meeting these thresholds was considered successful feasibility. Participants who provided informed consent were randomised to the SUMIT or control group. Group allocation was blinded, and both groups were assessed at baseline. Once randomised, the SUMIT group received access to the website, and the SUMIT group received one-on-one motivational interviewing online or via phone in weeks 1, 2, 4, 7, and 10. Both groups were reassessed at 12 weeks. I personally delivered the motivational interviewing following advanced training and one-on-one coaching with a psychologist, and sessions lasted around 30 minutes each. They included tailored content featuring the core principles of motivational interviewing, which are engaging, focusing, evoking, and or planning. Feasibility and demographics were reported descriptively, and between group changes for continuous variables were calculated using the analysis of covariance, or ANCOVA, with Bonferroni adjustment and baseline measures used as covariates. We intended to recruit 42 participants to account for dropouts with an aim of analysing 30 participants. Due to the severe impacts of COVID-19 lockdowns in Victoria during 2021, we concluded recruitment at 32 participants. So in terms of our feasibility results, 9 participants were eligible per month over 7 months, which ticked off our criteria of 9 per month. Just 5 participants were enrolled and randomised, which did not meet our criteria of 6 per month. 100% of motivational interviewing sessions were attended online within the intended week. The active power wear time of 16 hours per day was met with 100% adherence. And we only had 2 dropouts, which is a low 6% of participants. Here we've got the change scores for our secondary variables. The difference between groups for steps per day was negligible. However, the SUMIT group walked faster and more often in longer bouts, which may explain why they took fewer steps per day. Walking speed and KOO's quality of life were the only statistically significant findings. However, large confidence intervals that mostly cross zero are expected, as our limited efficacy testing was not powered to find between group differences. So we've demonstrated that SUMIT is feasible for a large-scale trial. All feasibility criteria were either met or could be reasonably altered to be met in future trials. This includes increasing advertising and recruiting participants prospectively as they complete GLAD. Limited efficacy testing revealed promising trends towards the SUMIT group, including increases in moderate to vigorous physical activity, which is likely to lead to health improvements and reduce the risk of premature mortality. Motivational interviewing is unlikely to be successful in people who don't want to change. Therefore, including GLAD participants in a larger trial is more likely to be successful in increasing physical activity. However, this should eventually be studied in people who have not necessarily completed an education and exercise program to improve generalizability. So what does this mean? Given the promising initial findings, clinicians may wish to have open conversations with patients about physical activity and could consider training courses if interested in trying motivational interviewing. Our trial tested a novel intervention and may be a future key component to addressing insufficient physical activity in people with knee osteoarthritis. Thank you for coming along. And if you're interested in the full text, the open access link is just there with the QR code.
Fantastic. Thanks very much, Emily. So knee osteoarthritis, I assume, is prevalent in Australia. And all the interventions involve use of personnel. So what if you did a large-scale trial and found that it was positive, how would you envisage that that would be rolled out into the community?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I think it's something that's going to continue to develop. I think particularly given that GLAD itself requires personnel and is still being rolled out, it's something we could follow a similar model with that and potentially provide additional training to people who already provide GLAD to then do motivational interviewing as well. And whether or not it's something that could be provided alongside the GLAD program might be beneficial as well. I think an ongoing barrier that we're going to face that is still something that GLAD itself faces is funding. And I know that there is a huge database with over 10,000 people on it that's growing every day, where we're finding we're seeing those improvements in pain, function, quality of life, that sort of thing for GLAD participants. So hopefully that's something that as a first step can receive some funding or at least co-funding from government sources or private health initiatives, and something like SUMIT will hopefully follow in its tracks, but it's certainly a long-term plan at this stage.
Fantastic. Thanks very much.
Pleasure.
So if we don't have any other questions, we'll move on to the second presentation. The second presentation is by Sunny Lee. And she's the winner of the Student Undertaking a Higher Degree study. She's doing a Master's of PhD. And her presentation is optimization of heart failure medications on discharge at a single tertiary hospital.
Hey everyone, my name is Sunny. Today I'm going to present my heart failure research project. First up, just some introduction about me and my project. So right now I'm a pharmacist working at Cabrini who just complete my internship training last year. So right now I'm progressing my further studies in medicine at Monash University. So right now I'm in Gippsland in my student accommodation. So sorry for my background. So for this research project, it was conducted last year in 2023, was part of my Master of Pharmacy program at Monash University. It's a very small and simple project just to explore the latest prescribing pattern of heart failure medications post admissions. So just quickly for the presentation outlines, so due to the limitation, I only have 10 to 15 minutes. I'll run through everything very briefly, but we're going to have some time in the end if you have any questions. So it's in a logical order of the research. So I'm just going to talk about the background, literature review, aims, methods, results, discussion, and conclusion. So first out, a little bit of background on heart failure, but I'm sure everyone here knows probably more than I do. So heart failure, briefly speaking, it's just a structural or functional problem of the heart. So the resulting effect is a reduced cardiac output and subsequent oxygenation of the body's vital organs. And some of the quick stats worth noting as well. So in 2019, there's about 480,000 Australians living with heart failure. And in Australia, there's about 60,000 hospitalizations for heart failure recorded in 1 year period. So the reported readmission and mortality rates after 1 year post hospitalization for heart failure were quite high. They're sitting at 56% and 25% respectively. So from the stats, you can see due to the need of ongoing care for heart failure, this really imposes a substantial burden on the healthcare system due to the high rates of readmission. So here I would like to clarify some of the heart failure medications abbreviations I'm going to use a lot in this talk. So first up, we can see these are all evidence-based therapies. So these are the ACE inhibitors, ARB, ARNI, which is ontrestal, MRA, which is commonly known as spironolactone, SGLT2, one of the diabetic medications, but it's newly proven to help heart failure and is now considered one of the standard evidence-based therapies for all heart failure patients, regardless if they have diabetes or not. And then we have the heart failure-specific beta blockers here. And then the second category, they are symptomatic control therapies. These are the loop diuretics, such as furosemide, hydrochlorothiazide, and digoxin. Next up is just literature review. I just want to highlight that there are four classes of evidence-based therapies that all heart failure patients should be go on. And these are the four classes here. And the logic of my research gap is although Australian domestic heart failure guidelines is a bit outdated, so the latest one is released in 2018 compared to some other international guidelines, which included the SGLT2, the new diabetic medication, as one of the standard therapies, but other guidelines has yet include that update. It's PBS listed, but it just didn't update in the guidelines yet. And second, so there are a very few studies report the prescribing patterns of the heart failure medications, especially in the hospital settings, and none since the PBS listing of SGLT2. Lastly, the current research literature confirmed the gap in evidence-based therapy used in real-world clinical practice. So that's why hopefully my small project will come in handy and fill this small gap, just to determine the prevalence of heart failure medications. So just right now, after the changes in evidence and et cetera, just to determine how we're doing at the moment and go from there. So the methods are quite simple as well. So we just get the coded admissions and then screen the medical records and then apply the inclusion criteria. So basically, it's anyone got admitted that has a new heart failure diagnosis or have a heart failure exacerbation during their admission. So then we have 216 admissions over a 6 month period, and that's comprised of 200 different patients. And so this is the results section. So this we can see the graph. So the blue bar is the percentage of different medication prescribed the patients have on admission. And the orange bar is the percentage on discharge. So we can see the first five columns are the evidence-based therapy. So overall, the prescribing is still relatively low. But there are some good changes we can see, you know, for there is a big increase for the MRA. So a lot of the doctors actually put patients on spironolactone on discharge, and the p-value is quite significant as well. So this is definitely a good change. And also we can see, observe the similar trend in the heart failure specific beta blockers as well. So there is a good increase compared from admission to discharge. We can see the highest prescribing is the loop diuretics, which is commonly furosemide. So I'm going to talk about in the discussion as well why we have such a high prescribing in furosemide. But I thought this is a good presentation of what the prevalence is like for heart failure medications prescribing. And this one is another interesting results as well. So because we encourage all the patients to go on the four classes of heart failure evidence-based therapies. So in my study, so there's 9 out of 216 admissions. So the patients are 4.2% on discharge. They are taking all four classes of the medications. And this is a study Dr. Nathan Better sent it to me, which is quite interesting. This just explores other data in other four developed countries. So we can see that we're just in the, we're doing a lot better than the UK and the US. So they are sitting at 1.5%. That's how many patients are on the four classes of medications, but we're lower than Japan and Sweden. We're sitting at 7.1% and 11.3%. So we can see there's definitely room for improvement. So next is discussion. So overall, the prescribing rates, as you can see, are still generally quite low for all the evidence-based therapies. But there are some reasons for that. First, the primary cohort, you know, when they presented to the hospital because they had an exacerbation of heart failure. So that probably explains why the doctors will lean towards to the symptomatic control and put them on furosemide to induce diuresis for those symptomatic control therapy rather than the preventative therapies. So that explains why we have such a high prescribing of furosemide. Second reason is most of our patient in the study has advanced age. So 54% of the patients were older than 85 years old. So and a lot of them have you know, long-term background medical conditions such as CKD, chronic kidney disease. So 47% of the patients have CKD, which limit the use of ACE inhibitors, ARNI, and the new diabetic medication SGLT2 in these patient groups as well. So that just sort of explains why we observe those trends in the results section. Lastly, just conclusion. So as we can see, we explored the prescribing pattern of heart failure medications at discharge. Overall, the prescribing is low, but also highlights the challenges and also good opportunities this time to improve medication optimization in heart failure patients. So further studies should explore strategies on how to optimize or improve these evidence-based prescribing for these heart failure patients while they're in the hospital. And lastly, I got this direct quote from the US heart failure guidelines, which I thought is a quite nice summary to summarize this small project. So basically, hospitalization for heart failure is a critical opportunity to continue, initiate, and further optimize those guidelines-directed therapies. So it has been shown that the continuation of those therapies really lower the risk of post-discharge death and readmission compared with discontinuation. This is a slide, probably not relevant to everybody, but I know a lot of pharmacists were in this meeting as well. Thank you so much for coming. But it's a slide I showed to other Cabrini pharmacists of how we can do from the pharmacy perspective to improve the medication prescribing and how we can interact with doctors or prompt them to discuss whether we can, how we can optimize before the time of discharge. And I thought it's a good slide to share with you all. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. So just because of the audience, I get the opportunity to share my project with more people. So this one, I also made a poster as well. I presented at Monash University in front of the newly graduate pharmacists. Also, I presented this with the other pharmacy departments, so everyone is well aware of my project. So this one, I'm also at the final stage of publishing this at the journal, International Journal of Pharmacy Practice, so also known as IJPP. So hopefully I can submit my paper by the end of this week. These are some of the references, and also a huge acknowledgement to a lot of people here. It's a team effort, especially to my preceptor, Robert, who is also here, and also Dr. Nathan Butter, who gave me a lot of advice on study design and how to collect the data. And also Dr. Mohammad is here as well, who helped me with my stats and graph analysis and with p-value calculations. All right, thank you, everybody here. I know I've run through everything really quickly, but any questions for me?
So I was going to ask you a question, Sunny.
Yeah.
Did you record who the patients were admitted under? So like a cardiologist or a general med person or some other person?
No, but in the data collection, I did put the department as medical or cardiology, but I didn't record the doctor's name.
And is one department better than another, or is it all the same?
I didn't do that analysis yet. It wasn't in, but I guess if you're really interested, I can find out.
Well, it would be kind of interesting to know whether cardiologists.
It's actually a great
better.
Question, Gary, and because there's actually been other trials have actually done looking at, you know, heart failure management in terms of cardiologists versus general medicine, and obviously the articles were written by cardiologists and shown cardiologists are better at it, but in fact it's very individually driven. And when we designed this trial, we specifically didn't ask for individual doctors because the idea was to try to see how we're performing as a hospital rather than comparing one doctor to another. So we deliberately left that out of the framework, Gary.
Beautiful. Yeah, no, sure. Paul McMurray's got a question.
Yeah, not often you'll get a colorectal surgeon ask a question while I'm working on cardiology, but, you know, I thought I'd throw my hat in the ring. The question to you, Nathan, really is, what is the optimal percentage in this setting? I mean, you've got a mixed group of patients. A big chunk of them are over 85. They've got a lot of comorbidities.
I'm sorry, you were cut out a little. I didn't really get the full question. Can you repeat that? I'm so sorry.
I think what he's asking is Paul's at some remote place in the world, so he may not come back on for a while. So I think what he's asking is, compared to the percentage that you got, what do you think the optimal percentage is that we should aim for?
I think 50% is probably a good starting point because right now we can see a lot of the evidence-based therapies are below 50. So the best we're doing is probably the MRA, the spironolactone, is sitting around 40-something percent. So hopefully we can try to, you know, get all the evidence-based therapy around the 50% mark, you know, including the ACE inhibitors and the beta blockers. I think 50% would be a good starting point. And yeah, in my opinion.
And then my final question probably should go to Nathan. So Nathan, if you have a patient with cardiac failure, should they all be referred to a cardiologist?
I think the answer to that is probably no. We're starting to develop a system where we actually are working quite well with the general medicine people, also with the geriatricians. We've now obviously this concept of also heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, or HEFPEF, is becoming more and more recognized. Up until about probably a year ago, there was no recognized treatments for it. Now there are treatments which are actually approved in terms of benefit. And just the quantity of patients that are going to come through here, they're going to turn up in geriatric circles. And I think usually it's probably best managed as a combined thing. Does every patient need to come? I think probably the answer is no. But I think we really as a group have to sort of find the selected patients which should come to cardiology, which patients should get more investigations. And I think as Sunny has shown quite beautifully, we really are underdoing as a group right across the board the amount of heart failure therapies that are used. And I'd like to see, you know, 2 or 3 years' time that these numbers increase dramatically.
Okay, thanks, Sunny. That was a great presentation. Well done. Our last presentation is from one of the superstars, or the superstar of Cabrini Research, and that's Associate Professor Mohammad Asghari-Jafarabadi. Mohammad is going to, he's won the Publication of the Year award for survival prediction and prognostic factors in colorectal cancer after curative surgery, insights from Cox regression and neural networks. And that was published in Scientific Reports last year. So over to you, Mohammad, and try to make it understandable for the rest of us, because I know that you're a mathematical genius and we're not.
Thank you, Gary. Hello, everybody. Here is Mohammad, Vice President of Cabrini Research. And I want to take this opportunity to extend my gratitude to the selection panel, choosing my publication as the publication of the year at Cabrini. In this presentation, I will talk about motivation, modeling, network structure, data description results, discussion and conclusion, and finally, CRC is increasing in low and middle income countries due to the rising of prevalence of modifiable risk, like poor diet and sedentary lifestyle. Also, CRC is one of the most curable cancers, and the survival probability can be increased if found earlier and proper action are taken risk factor wise. On the other hand, Cox regression is a model that is a popular and widely accepted and commonly employed method in survival analysis, especially in the cancer studies. And neural networks based analytical methods are become increasingly popular because they are very well known for the ability to capture complex relationship and structure in data. And they can improve their learning performance, and it can be a robust alternative to the Cox regression. So we aim to compare the predictive ability of artificial neural network compared to the conventional Cox regression in predicting survival of patients with CRC after curative surgery. Here is the mathematical model of Cox regression. And for ANN, it has a complex structure, which I will show in the next slide. And the ANN use Cox-based modeling, but with a more complex structure, which is the black box of the artificial neural network. You can see the network structure in this slide. And, first stage, we have input layers, which are independent variables or risk factors. And the risk factors are put into the next layer, which is called hidden layer, by a complex relationship, nonlinear relationship, including interactions, second order, third order, and whatever composite relationship that you can imagine. But you don't know about any type of the complex relationship here, which is called the black box of the artificial neural network. And in the next step, the hidden layer are connected to the output layer, which is outcome variable with a activation function. And finally, we can predict the outcome variable. And in this stage, the neural network using backpropagation algorithm use the feedback of the final layer and produce some weights and back the weights into the input layer to improve weights in repeated process to finally improve the performance of the neural networks and finally for a better prediction of the outcome. We split data into train and test by 70% and 30% respectively. We use likelihood estimation for the Cox regression and a multi-layer perceptron and backpropagation algorithm for the neural networks. And we tuned the hyperparameters in ANN utilizing a research. We used a number of 14 risk factors at input variable, 5 layers in the hidden layer, and 2 nodes per layer, and a learning rate of 1% and a logistic activation function, which results in the optimal model for our ANN model. And the optimal model selection between ANN and Cox was based on diagnostic measures such as sensitivity, specificity, positive predictive value, negative predictive value, accuracy, and area under the rock curve. which was coded in R and stuff. Our data was based on a cohort study of 284 patients with CRC who underwent surgery, were referred to a hospital clinic from 2001 to 2017. And demographic, clinical, and histological information was extracted from patients' records, including age, gender, BMI, metastasis to other site, chemotherapy, grade, tumor size, TN, and stage. And medical variables, recurrence, and death was confirmed based on a telephone follow-up. For the results of comparing ANN and CARTS for the death outcome, we had a comparable sensitivity for ANN and CARTS models, a better positive predictive value around 5% better in the ANN. But for all other indices, we had a better performance for the CARTS regression against our expectation. Also for death after recurrence outcome, the sensitivity of the ANN was a bit better than CARTS model, but for all other indices, CARTS regression outperformed the ANN in predicting the outcome. In this slide, we can see the results of multivariate CARTS regression model for both recurrence and death, along with the radar plots showing the results of the ANN model. We can see that for the CARTS regression model, we have some significant predictors like age, metastasis to other site, number of chemotherapies, grade, disease stage, and PN stage. And we can see that for the CARTS regression, we have the established effect size of hazard ratio and 95% CI and p-value for the significance of the results. In the other side, for ANN, we have just the weight, which is between 0 and 100. And no significant results, and just weight. We have to categorize weights, for example, into four categories by cut points like 25, 50, 70, 75 to show the importance of the variable. For example, in this case, metastasis to other site is one of the most important and influential variable in both recurrence and death outcomes. At 100% of the importance weight. Both models, ANN and CARTS regression, had a great performance in dice, most indices, 80% and higher. But generally, CARTS regression outperformed the ANN in the prediction of the outcomes. And we see some significant predictors based on CARTS regression, metastasis to other site, disease stage, and PN stage for both outcomes. And generally, our aim here was to predict the mortality, overall mortality, and mortality after recurrence. But when we shift our objective to describe the relationship between risk factors and outcomes, the CARTS regression is a better one because it provides the established effect size of hazard ratio 95% CI along with the significance. But ANN only provides some weights. We have to categorize them. But here for our objective as the predictive ability of the ANN and CARTS regression, we saw that CARTS regression outperformed the ANN as well, and this was a result that was not expected based on what we have seen in the research. Future directions based on this study, especially for our data set here at Cabrini, is utilizing of deep learning, a more advanced form of artificial neural networks, and utilizing all machine learning algorithms and super learners, and utilizing the causal pathway of the risk factors affecting the outcomes via structural equation modeling, hybrid with survival analysis. Here are some references. and I'm here for any questions and comments.
Another great presentation. Are there questions for Mohammad? Then I might just ask one. How would it be possible to embed this type of analysis into routine practice? And if you wanted to do that, how would you do it?
Yeah, exactly. A very good question, and you know, motivating. You know, starting for the analysis in some of our deficits here at Cabrini, especially colorectal cancer deficit, which is a valuable deficit. You know, we can use this method, artificial neural networks, and more advanced one, deep learning neural networks. And generally, all the machine learning methods that are, you know, very new to the research compared to the conventional statistical methods, we can use all of them in our data set here at Cabrini and every new research setting.
Are there any other questions for Mohammad? It's a shame Paul McMurrick's dropped off. He's somewhere in remote Australia using his satellite phone, which clearly isn't working very well. So that's a bit of a shame. But thanks, Mohammad, for that presentation. That was fantastic. I'll get you to unshare your screen. So I'd just like to thank the three presenters and congratulate them once again on the awards that they've won. It just highlights the high level of research that's been done at Cabrini. And I want to thank them and everyone else involved in research. So next meeting will be in a month. I'll see everyone then. Have a great day. See you later.